Our keynote address will be given by Dr. Marc, Agronin, who will present on building the better older brain. In fact, while I'm saying this, I think I'll pull up his slides. Marc Agronin, MD, is a board-certified adult and geriatric psychiatrist and the author of the acclaimed book, How We Age, A Doctor's Journey into the Heart of Growing Old. He joined the staff of the Miami Jewish Health Systems, Florida's largest not-for-profit long-term care provider, in 1999, serving as the director of mental health services and the founding director of the Memory Center and Alzheimer's Clinical Research Program. In 2015, Dr. Agronin was promoted to Vice President for Behavioral Health and Clinical Research at Miami Jewish Health Systems. He is also an affiliate associate professor of psychiatry and neurology at the University of Miami Miller School of Medicine. Dr. Agronin is a graduate of Harvard University, summa cum laude, and is the Yale School of Medicine. He completed his residency training in adult psychiatry at Harvard University's McLean Hospital and then a geriatric psychiatry fellowship at the Minneapolis VA Medical Center. Dr. Agronin is the 2008 recipient of the Clinician of the Year Award from the American Association for Geriatric Psychiatry and is a distinguished fellow of the American Psychiatric Association. He's also received numerous other local and national awards. Dr. Agronin is a national expert in Alzheimer's disease and other geriatric mental health issues and runs both the Memory Center and Florida's largest Alzheimer's clinical research program. In addition to How We Age, he is the author of 8 other books and hundreds of articles, including Therapy with Older Clients, Key Strategies for Success, Principles and Practice of Geriatric Psychiatry, Alzheimer's Disease and Other Dementias, A Practical Guide. And his new book is The Dementia Caregiver, A Guide to Caring for Someone with Alzheimer's Disease and Other Neurocognitive Disorders. Dr. Agronin has been published in the New York Times and Scientific American Mind and writes regular blogs on aging and retirement issues for the Wall Street Journal, as well as part of the experts panel. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Marc Agronin.
Thank you so much. My mother loves that introduction. First of all, Dr. Jorgensen, I want to thank you sincerely for the invitation to be here. I'm really honored and blessed to speak in front of all of you today. I have to tell you, when I first got the invitation, I ran downstairs to speak to one of my closest colleagues at work, our director of development, who is working with us to build some really unique projects in Miami. And she was so excited because she grew up in this area. Her family were some of the first pioneers who came over and settled in this area. And she told me how much of a very special and holy place I'm coming to. And I have to tell you how correct she is and how impressed and inspired I've been. Just a few short hours I've been here, seeing the beautiful campus here, meeting students and the faculty. So sincerely, my gratitude for being here. And I'm very happy to speak to you about an area that is not only my passion, but I know it's a passion that many of you share. And that is aging, and in particular, how we can make a difference with our aging selves. Now, it's interesting because often when I speak to audiences, especially in the Miami area, a majority of the individuals are older, in their 80s and 90s, and this audience looks very different. So I realize I'm going to have to make a few adjustments en route, but I think that will work out. So typically when we think about aging, when we talk about aging, a lot of negativity comes into the discussion. Now, I work as a geriatric psychiatrist in Miami, seeing lots of individuals who are really suffering from many age-related conditions. And so you would think that my perspective would be somewhat of a gloomy one. If all you see all day are individuals who really are dealing with the problems of aging, it might not give you much of a perspective on what can be positive. And yet I've really seen the opposite. And so that's part of the message I want to share with you this evening, is not the problems we have to look forward to as we get older, but what are some of the promises? And when I talk about building a better brain, it's not just a brain, but it's a body and a spirit that we're really building and improving upon. So I want to open up the discussion with two key questions to think about, and this will set the stage for our discussion. Now, I realize for some of you, this might be a difficult question to answer. But when do you think you made better decisions, at your current age or when you were 18? Now, I suppose there are few of you in the audience who are probably closer to 18 than an older age, so you have to project yourself in the future. But think about that. And I think most people would say as they get older, they make better decisions. Now, that's an important statement, because if we're going to think about or talk about aging as a process of decline, why is it, somewhat paradoxically, that as we get older, we see ourselves as making better decisions? So that's the first question I want to pose to you. The second question is, do you think that your decision-making and perspectives will be better or worse when you are in your 80s and 90s? So think about that. What do you expect? What do you imagine? What have you seen? Because how we think about this can actually make a difference in terms of what will actually take place. So I use these two questions to really frame the discussion this evening. Now, I'm going to focus on three basic topics. Number one is, let's talk about what happens to the brain as we get older, because obviously, if we're going to think about making a better brain, we better understand what happens to just our normal, regular brain during the course of aging. Second, what does it even mean to have a better brain? What are we looking for? What are our expectations? And I'm going to define that by certain attributes that I think really make the difference. And third, how do we get there? What's the formula? This is the question everyone has. Is it a secret pill or potion? Is it some approach? So we'll get to that sooner or later. So let me begin by framing this discussion of how we look at the aging process. And I want to tell you a story that happened about a year ago. I was called to a little birthday celebration on campus for a medical director who was turning 50. Now, you know, if you're 18 or 19 or 20, 50 might seem pretty old. But 50 is not old. But this is the gift that he was presented with. It's the Dr. D. Crepit's over-the-hill survival kit. It was a small black bag they presented to him. You can see there's this caricature of a somewhat balding, loony-looking doctor on it. And inside this bag were two items: the 50 Sucks candy-flavored lollipops and the Old Geezer Lost Your Marbles replacement pack. So they gave him these gifts, and everyone was chuckling. And of course, as a geriatric psychiatrist, I had to take a step back and look at this a little deeper. And I thought, you know, this is interesting that what are we really doing here? We're laughing at aging. We're poking fun at aging. If someone gave him a gag gift that made fun of his background, his religion, his gender, we wouldn't be laughing. In fact, we would rightfully be offended by something like that. It would not be, forget about political correctness, it would just be a prejudiced thing to do. But why is it that aging is still a target? Why is it that we still think it's okay to laugh and poke fun at aging? And this is not a rare gift. If you look at birthday cards as people getting older, they tend to poke fun at decline and decrepitude and all the problems that we accrue. And so the problem is that this begins to form our image of aging. Now, what is the logical endpoint to something like this? Well, there's an article that came out in The Atlantic two, three years ago by a very renowned medical ethicist by the name of Ezekiel Emanuel. Incidentally, he's the brother of Rahm Emanuel, who was Obama's first chief of staff. And he wrote something interesting. He said, "Why I hope to die at 75. He said, "Death is a loss, but living too long is also a loss. I would no longer be vibrant and engaged, but feeble, ineffectual, even pathetic. Aging brings a constricting of our ambitions and expectations with memories framed not by our vivacity, but by our frailty." Now, I was really shocked when I read this article, because he is essentially saying that when we get older, and again, 75 is hardly old In my clinic, the average age is 90, so a 75-year-old is like a teenager. But he is essentially saying that there's no value beyond a certain point. He doesn't say he'll actually kill himself when he gets to age 75, but he says he won't do anything to actively promote his life. I find this shocking. I find it disturbing. And it really says something about aging. It basically is defining a good aging as an age in which we are only active and independent, can do everything we want. And once that begins to change, that there's no value to it. And if that's the way we perceive aging, if that's how we define it, I think we're in for trouble when we get older. And I think it's trouble for our society as well. So I really want to give a counterpoint to this perspective and talk about how we can really shape our lives to do that. So let's begin by talking about aging, the effects of aging on our brain. Now, I'm going to start off with a very scientific definition of the aging process. So this is right out of a book called The Biology of Aging. So Robert Arking defines aging as a time-dependent series of cumulative, progressive, intrinsic, and deleterious functional and structural changes that usually begin to manifest themselves at reproductive maturity and eventually culminate in death. Not the cheeriest definition of what aging is all about. In fact, it's true, it's accurate, but is it the whole picture? And my argument is that no, it's not. But this is how we tend to look at aging, define aging, think about aging. And again, my point being that if that's how we look at it, if that's our perspective, it leads naturally to conclusions as we get older that really put it down. This is the philosophy behind that gag gift that my colleague got on his 50th birthday. So, but let's talk about what does happen with the brain, because we know that if you look at brain cells, three basic things happen. Number one, they get dirty. They build up all sorts of junk in them as we get older. It's more difficult for the cells to get rid of this junk. Picture a house that just accumulates more and more dust and clutter. It's more difficult to get around and to do what you need to do. So the neurons do less. They don't produce as many neurotransmitters. They don't communicate signals as efficiently. And if we look at memory processing speed, mathematical abilities, reading ability, there's no question as we get older that we measuring with paper and pencil that we see declines in some of these abilities. This is often what people describe. If you talk to someone older, what do they often describe? I can't remember this. I don't remember what happened last week. It's on the tip of my tongue, but I can't quite remember it. And the worry is that neurons die over time, and we know that, at least we think, that we can't get new brain cells once they're gone. And so again, this paints a rather disturbing picture of what's going on in our brain as we get older. If you look at an older brain, it's smaller. It's more shrunken than a younger brain. So think about this. Why is it that we still say that we make better decisions as we get older, our perspective changes, and yet we're still looking at a brain which seems to be in decline? So again, let's examine this more, because this might not be the full picture. If you actually look at IQ testing over time, there's two things we see with age. Number one is our fluid intelligence, defined by problem solving, reasoning, pattern recognition, short-term memory. We know that we tend to peak in our 30s to 40s, and then it begins to go downhill. Now, it's variable, but there's no question that an 80-year-old brain will not process as quickly as a 30-year-old brain. Similar to, if you could, you know, there's a fascinating graph I saw of the fastest times at the 50-yard dash from age 20 to 90. Now, first of all, it's remarkable how fast some 90-year-olds can run the 50-yard dash, but they certainly are not running as fast as a 20-year-old. And so, same thing, if you measure the brain based on these discrete abilities, you see declines with fluid intelligence. Now, crystallized intelligence is a little different. These are our skills, our knowledge base, our vocabulary, that tends to remain a lot more stable for longer, and it can improve and grow as we get older, but even that in our 80s and 90s begins to decline. So if we're measuring ourselves based on an MRI of our brain or an IQ test, there's no question that you will see predictable, consistent declines over time. This is it graphed out from the Seattle Longitudinal Study of Aging, and you can see it's a downward curve. This is how many people define aging. This essentially is aging in their minds, that it's all downhill. So I want to challenge this and think about, is this really a full perspective on aging? This is undeniable. We know we face these changes. If you get old yourself, if you're in your 80s and 90s, or you work with people, you see these changes. They're obvious. We can't deny them, and there's no reason why we should deny them. But again, we have to think of the fact that we're only looking at a certain perspective here. And of course, the real specter here is the fact that as we get older and more people are living with healthy bodies, relatively healthy bodies, into their 70s, 80s, and 90s, but at the flip side is that the rates of dementia, of brain disease that results in cognitive and functional decline, increases dramatically. So much so, but by the age of 85, if everyone in this room were 85, literally half of you would have some degree of Alzheimer's disease. And that's daunting. Now, I spend my day working with people with Alzheimer's disease, trying desperately to find an effective treatment or a cure. But I can tell you, this is a very complex disease. We still have a long way to go. So this is one of the greatest challenges we face. But at the same time, I am not willing to buy into Emmanuel's perspective or solely look at aging as a process of decline in disease. You certainly can do that, but it's a very limited perspective. And that's the good news, because not everything declines. Some things get better. And as we'll talk about, you can maintain and train your brain. So this slide is important because I know we've hit somewhat of low point talking about what perhaps you can anticipate and expect with your aging brain. So let's see if there's a different side of the coin here that we can focus on. Let's talk about the attributes of a better brain, what that would entail, so we know what we want to try to aim for. So I've divided this up into three pillars that, to me, focus on the real strengths of aging. The first one is reserve. This is our protective base of skills and knowledge that continues to grow throughout our lifetimes and we can use as a form of mental currency or insurance as we get older. And I'll talk about that reserve. Second, resilience. This is how we rebalance ourselves in the face of stress or adversity, how we cope with that, and maybe the aging process can actually help us in that regard. And the third pillar is reinvention. I also use the term renewal. This is the ability to make changes later in life, sometimes in response to difficult situations, but sometimes in response to opportunity as well, and to play on our strengths. So let's look in more detail. The concept of reserve is really important. This grid of observations that lots of individuals who have some degree of brain damage from an injury, from a disease, do not necessarily show effects of it, or it's variable. If you've known someone who's had a stroke, some people have really profound deficits, other people do better. What determines that? What makes a difference? So we can look at it in terms of our brain reserve and our cognitive reserve. Brain reserve refers to just the number of cells, the density of cells, how connected the cells are in your brain. And the more stuff that's in there, the more resistant you are to damage over time, and that seems obvious. Cognitive reserve is all the built-up skills and knowledge and abilities that also helps buffer some of those changes. So, for example, if I've worked with someone who is an accountant, as they develop Alzheimer's disease, their mathematical skills are so far above the average that it might take much longer to notice a difference. They can compensate in many ways quicker, differently than other individuals. So this is what we call our cognitive reserve. And these concepts are important because, number one, we can continue to build this up. This is our mental insurance. This is why you're sitting here listening to a lecture, at least I hope. This is why you're taking classes here, learning skills and knowledge, not only to live out a purpose in life, to do some good in our world, but also you're banking this year by year by year, and We'll talk about how you can express this later in life. So these terms are really critically important. And one thing I want to emphasize is that it's really not so much about how many brain cells you have, but about how well connected they are. In fact, you have more brain cells before you're born than the day you're born. Your brain has literally sculpted away half your brain cells because you don't need them. It's all about connectivity here, which is a wonderful analogy for everything else in life. So because we have this reserve in our brain, we're able to adjust and cope to damage, what we call neuroplasticity, the ability of the brain to reroute itself, rewire, deal with damage. If you've known someone who had a head injury, you've seen this over time, that often people can really make extraordinary gains, especially if they're really training and working the brain over time. And there's three particular explanations for this. One is called STACK. It stands for the Scaffolding Theory of Aging and Cognition. And basically what it says is that over time, this reserve you build up is like a protective scaffolding around your brain. And so this allows you, when part of your brain is damaged or not working as well, to kind of use other parts of your brain. And there's two really interesting ways to describe this. One is called CRUNCH and one is called HERALD. CRUNCH stands for compensation-related utilization of neural circuits. And basically it's saying that if the left side of your brain isn't fit fully for the task, you can bring in the right side of your brain or a different part of your brain to compensate. So your brain in many ways is more balanced. You're not thinking only with one part of your brain, you're thinking with different parts of your brain. There's also the term HERALD, hemispheric asymmetry reduction in older adults, and that's really focusing on switching from left to right brain or right to left brain. This gives us a different perspective. I remember seeing a small newspaper article a number of years ago talking about how our brain declines as we get older because the areas of the brain are not as well separated from one another, that they begin to kind of mesh together. That doesn't have to be a weakness. That can be a great strength because instead of using just one part of the brain, we can use many parts of the brain. Why is it that our decision-making changes as we get older? Why do our perspectives change? Why are we less emotionally reactive to situations? In part, it's because of these reserves and how our brain changes with time. We tend to have a more balanced perspective on things. We're not as emotionally reactive to situations. So what does that mean? It means that we're able to cope better, to think in different ways. There's a term called post-formal thinking, and this comes out of the work of Jean Piaget, who was a Swiss psychologist. He actually studied his own children and really noticed how their cognition developed over time. And he said that the ultimate development in the human brain is what's called formal operations. This is as an adolescent, as a young teenager, you've reached the peak. You're able to think abstractly. And that's where your development stops. And so many theorists after that said, well, just wait a minute. It doesn't just stop at that point. There's a lot of development and change and growth beyond formal operations called post-formal thinking. This is our ability to look at both sides of the coin and realize it doesn't necessarily have to be a contradiction. We can look at competing systems and relationships. We can look at our own perspective amidst a sea of different perspectives. It doesn't mean that everything is relative, but it just means that we can appreciate the differences and the tension between different perspectives and we can balance it out. And this really feeds into a different perspective as we get older. The work of Laura Karstensen has been really critical here. She's a Stanford psychologist, and what she says is that the older brain tends to focus more on positive images, feelings, experiences. And one of the reasons she feels this is the case is because we do this mental calculation as we get older that the horizon of life is much closer, and if we're going to make decisions today, it better have meaning for us. This is akin to, you know, if not now, when? Act now. Focus on something that will really make a difference in the world, that will bring you a legacy, not just something only for yourself. And that this transformation begins later in life, and this, again, has a lot to do with how our perspectives broaden, in many ways become more altruistic, and gives us a whole different way of looking at the world. We can put this together into this term wisdom. Now, the term wisdom often gets stereotyped in a very narrow way, so I really want to expand how we think and look at wisdom. On the one hand, we know that wisdom relies on life experience, But it's not just having a lot of experience, it's being able to reflect upon that and apply it to different situations. Wisdom is not just one single trait. It's not, wisdom is not like your mathematical ability or your ability to talk. Wisdom has many different forms, almost like when you think of intelligence, and there's a theory of what's called multiple intelligences. And I think wisdom can also be looked in that same way. The other thing is that wisdom has a value to it, a valence to it. Usually when we say someone is wise or a decision is wise, it's because it's not just serving one person, but serving the community. It's serving a higher purpose, a higher good. And we also know that it's rooted in the brain, and the brain changes in ways, not just declining, but in ways, we've talked about post-formal thinking, we've talked about this balancing the brain, but it changes in ways that enables us to be wiser as we get older. Now, I like to put this into a certain scheme. I actually I have a book coming out later this year which is really focusing on the strengths of aging. And so I've divided up wisdom into five different types because I think this is a way for everyone to think about what are your different components of wisdom, how do you exercise this, and we can look at older people or our aging selves and think about what wisdom is for us. So I say there's a savant. A savant is someone who, and I'm not using this in the traditional sense of someone who's a particular genius in one area, although that does apply here, but someone who has an extraordinary knowledge or ability or skills in one different area. I'll give you an example. I work with a woman who, from generations back from Sicily, she holds all the recipes in the family. She does all the cooking for the family. Every Sunday they get together. She is a savant when it comes to creating not just food, but sustenance, not just physically, but spiritually for her family every Sunday. You can't find that in a recipe book. You have to see that. You have to witness this. You have to participate with this. Even at 94, she was leading the whole Sunday event. A sage is someone who really takes that wisdom and applies it to decision-making. Every family group, every community, society has people who, as they get older, are able to really have that wise balancing of different perspectives. Those are the individuals that we go to for advice, for counsel, to know how to address different situations. That's another type of wisdom. Another person I call curator. This is someone who has empathy and care for other people. Their approach, their service is to try to preserve a certain value in the community, and so it's a very active form of wisdom. Then there are people who are very artistic. They're creators later in life. And many people discover an artistic skill later in life, and that really becomes a focus for them. In fact, if you look at many of the greatest folk artists in this country, most of them either started their skill or really reached the peak of it much later in life. And then finally, the seer, the individual who has a really spiritual and transcendent view. And this often comes to people much later in life, especially as they get closer to the ending of life, and they really develop a way of being able to look back on their life and have a sense of meaning and completeness for it, and also really have an intense spirituality. And we know that people who have different forms of wisdom tend to have a greater sense of life satisfaction, a greater sense of well-being, a greater sense of purpose. They're more productive. So wisdom in later life is not just a nice trait that people have, but in some ways it's a life-saving trait. It makes all the difference. Along with that, we can see how this translates into resilience, the ability to deal with adversity and rebalance one's perspective over time. And we know that if you look at a lot of situations, and I think Hurricane Katrina was one perfect example where, without question, older individuals were more vulnerable physically. The mortality rate was much higher among older individuals who were directly affected by the hurricane. But if you look at how people coped psychologically, older people did better than younger people. Rates of post-traumatic stress disorder tended to be lower. And so that mental resilience actually increases, improves with age. So that's another strength that we gain as we get older. Now again, as I'm talking about wisdom, creativity, it's hard to measure these things. You know, think about that downward slope. I'm describing things that certainly are not that downward slope, kind of going the opposite way. And so that's what this is a way of rebalancing that perspective in aging. Purpose makes an enormous difference. There's a really groundbreaking research initiative called the Middle Age in the United States Study, or the MIDAS Study, run out of Madison, Wisconsin. And researcher after researcher has found that individuals who have a higher sense of purpose do better, feel better, live longer, have fewer strokes, have fewer heart attacks. It's really extraordinary. If you ask me, well, what can I do to live longer? And we'll talk about some of the strategies later. But two of the most fundamental aspects have been, number one, having a sense of purpose, and number two, having a positive attitude towards aging. And I'll talk about a study later which really addresses that. I mentioned about creativity in later life, how it can really blossom for people. I'm sure you've heard of Grandma Moses. She was someone who devoted her life to raising her family. Not until her mid-70s did she really begin doing any form of artwork, became a world-renowned artist. Her art was in some ways simple, but colorful, profound. It really told the fabric of life in the United States, but it was her age-given perspective that allowed her to do this, to be more creative. And we see this all the time. Think also that creativity is not just about being an artist. You need creativity for problem solving, dealing with adversity, dealing with relationships. And so if creativity can increase and improve in later life, this also gives us a greater ability to deal with all of these different challenges that we face as we get older. Without question, spirituality can also deepen as we get older. We know that individuals who are more religious, who attend church more, who engage in prayer more, definitely do better in terms of their health. They have lower rates of depression. They tend to live longer. No question that makes a difference. There's also a term called gerotranscendence, which talks about a perspective that some people come to later in life where they have a much deeper understanding of the world around them, about what life is all about. That experience has taught them so deeply. Just because you have memory impairment doesn't mean that these things go away. In fact, if you work, and I heard earlier some really amazing descriptions from students who have worked in long-term care. When you work around people who even are towards the end of their life, even if they're suffering from really severe cognitive impairment, you can sometimes learn from them and see and witness just the most extraordinary perspective on life that helps us when we're younger. So if we put all this together, interesting to see what the end point is. Huge survey was done, about 350,000 people, and they wanted to know they looked at individuals at age 18 to 85, when do people have the highest degree of stress? If you were to guess, what age do you think is the most stressful age, and what's the least stressful age? So think about that. I'm not going to ask any hands or anything. But basically what they found is that the young people here, you're the most stressed out people in the survey. 18 to 22 is the peak, and guess what? It's all downhill from that there. 85-year-olds had the lowest amount of stress. So think about that. Finally, this is a curve you want to be on the downward slope of. What about well-being? Again, who do you think are the happiest? Who do you think are the least happy? And typically, if you ask younger people, middle-aged people, they don't think late life is a time of such happiness. But the survey showed that we start off really high sense of well-being, hit a low point around age 50, and then it increases. The highest degree of well-being were the 85-year-olds. Now, I have to tell you, when I first saw this survey and I lectured on it to a group of people in their 80s and 90s, I was really nervous because I thought they're going to come up to me afterwards and said, you don't know what you're talking about. Life is horrible or miserable. Quite the opposite. Everyone wanted to come up and say, this is right. This is true. I can do this now. I couldn't do this before. They wanted to talk about their new relationships, their new activities, everything they're involved in. And this is echoed in many different surveys. In fact, I know as a psychiatrist that rates of severe depression go down as we get older, not increased. You know, a lot of people say, well, isn't it depressing doing the work you do? No, not at all, because I see the opposite of depression in so many people, and that gives me inspiration for getting older. So that brings us to the final section, is how are you going to get there? So we've talked about the gloomy part of our brains and getting older, but we've balanced that out. We've talked about all the strengths that we also gain as we get older, and that would certainly make all the difference, because I think having a sense of purpose and meaning, being creative, makes all the difference later in life. That's what I see with people because from my perspective, I work with people that you really do get to see if people reap what they sow, because you see them in the last few years of your life, and no question that those elements really make the difference. So is there anything we can do to get there? So let's say I gave you three choices, and these choices could possibly make all the difference to either cure old age or at least give you the best old age. So think about what you would choose. So number one is a bottle of water from the fountain of youth. Number two is a youth restore potion. And number three, and I'm not endorsing anything here, I promise you that, chocolate, wine, and cigarettes. So, strange choice. So obviously the Fountain of Youth water is just a gimmick. In fact, if you come to Florida, you can go to St. Augustine, you can go to the park in St. Augustine where Ponce de Leon first stepped foot in this country, and they will sell you a bottle of Fountain of Youth water. I have some in my office. We're not gonna choose that. There are tons of pills, potions, brain tonics out there, jellyfish extract that people will claim make all the difference. They don't. Chocolate, wine, cigarettes, why would we even choose something like that? Okay, I'm not endorsing that, so please don't take it that way. But there's a story behind this. The woman who lived the oldest in history, Madame Calmont, a French lady who lived to be 122, saw the Eiffel Tower being built in her lifetime. When they asked, what is your secret? She said, number one, I eat several pounds of French chocolates every week. Number two, I have a glass of port wine every day. And at least up until the age of 116, she smoked two cigarettes every day. So again, is that why she lived to be 122? I don't think so. But it's making the point that we really don't know. There's a lot of uncertainty here. And if you're chasing after some crazy gimmick, this might not apply so much here, but I can tell you in Florida, people are chasing after all sorts of craziness. And so, let me just close this out. So her answer really tells us that it's maybe not what we think. A Dutch woman, Henrique van Andelschipper, lived to be 115. What was her secret? Glass of orange juice every day? Okay, that makes sense. And pickled herring. I'm not sure she combined the two, but remarkably, at the age of 112, they did IQ testing, and she tested out about an average 70-year-old. And they did an autopsy when she died, and her brain looked like a 70-year-old. And that's really extraordinary. So again, maybe the secret is not what we think it is. None of them exercise. You know, these individuals didn't live the type of, you know, lifestyles that we would imagine would bring us the better brain. Other secrets, well, the oldest living Japanese woman, her secret was she'd sleep for 2 days on and then be awake for 2 days and had lots of sushi. Oldest living Italian woman, raw eggs and brandy. And this one really pains me. The oldest living American, what do you think was her trick? Was it a vegan diet? Yogurt? Every day she had four strips of bacon. So there is no brain tonic that's going to make a difference here. I'm crossing that out. There is no special formula. People take tons and tons of the stuff. Maybe it's not in your cabinets here. I hope not, but I can tell you patients come in taking all sorts of craziness that makes no difference. They think it makes a difference. So what really does make a difference? I'm going to give you the formula here. Okay. Surprise, surprise, physical exercise. Now, I didn't give this whole talk just to say go exercise, but the bottom line is this. You don't need to become a triathlete to get the benefits here. That just regular exercise, doing something you enjoy doing so you'll keep on doing it, increases blood flow to the brain, reduces loss of brain tissue as we get older, and it causes our brain to release neurogrowth factors that help us sprout more connections. We talked about how connections are so important. Secondly, brain training, whether it's computer or not, there's been these big fancy studies. They show people did a little better. I say, forget about all these fancy programs out there, computer programs. Do something you enjoy that's mentally and socially stimulating. That will make as much difference as all these, because these are huge, expensive studies. The data was positive. Surprise, surprise, people study and learn and they gain knowledge. I don't think there's anything shocking about that. You can still learn as you get older. Do something you enjoy, you love, that stimulates your brain mentally and socially. And if you do that, mix it up a little bit. You don't just go to the gym and just work your biceps only. You'd have amazing biceps, but the rest of your body is going to be kind of flabby. Same thing with your brain. I know I learned today that this university teaches more languages than any other university in the country. That's amazing. Learning a new language helps the brain develop. So if you learn another language here, you have all the opportunities here to do that. Doing brain games that you enjoy doing, listening to other types of perspectives, listening to different type of music, these are all things that really condition our brain. The only diet that's really shown to make a difference in terms of risk reduction for dementia is a Mediterranean diet, and you can take out the main components of a colorful plate, lots of fruits and vegetables, focus more on a plant-based, less on meat, although there's nothing wrong with meat in moderation, lower in fat. A glass of wine is part of that, although, I know that's not always part of different cultures. But it's not a crazy diet. You know, people are on all sorts of craziness today that really doesn't support the fact that it makes a difference for their brain. So if you enjoy what you're eating, it's colorful, you're doing what you need to do. Jean Cohen proposes what's called a social portfolio. Remember that there are always things you can do regardless of whether you can have a group to do it with or you're on your own, whether you have a lot of mobility and energy or less mobility and energy. And it's a good lesson for people as they get older because they think, well, I can't walk as fast, I can't golf anymore, I can't ski anymore, my life is over. But they have to look in a broader fashion and look at all the different things that they're able to do. So I kind of put this in terms of what I call life portfolio based on this reserve, resilience, and reinvention that focus on the wisdom that you're gaining as you get older. You know, focus on volunteer work. The mission work which you do is amazing for your brain in addition to be amazing for the people that you work with. Get involved in the arts in particular and doing things creative. As people get older, they can look into encore careers, whether it's volunteering or actually taking up a new profession. But you have to be open to making changes. It doesn't mean giving everything up. We have potential as we get older, midlife, later in life. We have the ability to have a broader perspective. We talked about this in terms of wisdom, and Jean Cohen, who is one of the founding fathers of geriatric psychiatry, talks a lot about these potential phases as we get older. It's not just about kind of packing things in and wearing down. Attitude makes a difference. People with a more positive attitude in one study lived 7.5 years longer than people with less positive attitudes. And Becca Levy from Yale developed a stereotype embodiment theory, which basically says if you see yourself as decrepit and more impaired, you tend to perform that way. And if you see yourself as more capable, you tend to perform that way. These are really measurable things. There was a fascinating study called the counterclockwise study, which took a group of men and who were in their 70s and above, all had various medical issues, and they measured all their eyesight, their walking speed, their blood pressure, all this at baseline. And they put them in a van. They took them away to a monastery where everything was made to look like it was 1959 when these men were in their 20s. And they said, for the next week, you're going to think like it's 1959, act like it's 1959. All you're going to listen to is radio and TV from 1959. And at the end of that week, so this is in 1981, they study these men. They were walking faster, their posture was better, their vision was better, their hearing was better, their memory was better. How is it in 1 week of immersing themselves, thinking in a more positive way, it made a difference? It truly makes a difference. We don't tend to think about this. We think, you got to get out there and work yourself to the bone to make a difference. No, the attitude makes an enormous difference. So let me finish up with a story to bring all this together, because this illustrates every point in one. The famous French painter Matisse, known for big, beautiful, colorful murals. This is an image of him younger. During the Second World War, the Nazis overran France. His daughter was arrested by the Gestapo and taken away, almost tortured to death. His wife left him. He's left alone in the early 1940s, develops a horrible intestinal ailment, and has to have surgery. There were no antibiotics at the time. There weren't IVs at the time. Somehow he survived surgery, but he languished in bed for weeks. Now, a 72-year-old man in 1941 might as well be a 95-year-old person today lying almost on their deathbed. He didn't think he'd survive. He managed to survive, but he no longer could paint the way he used to. He couldn't stand and stretch. So you'd think his artistic life is over. Matisse would have none of that. Confined to a wheelchair, he had his aide, or his assistant, bring these beautiful, vivid, colorful pieces of paper to him. He'd take a scissors, and he would glide through the paper and cut all these different shapes and have his assistant paste it up on the wall. He literally developed a new art form, based on color. This book, Jazz, that came out in 1947, really revolutionized the world of art. This is a man who had been as old and decrepit and diseased on his deathbed as anyone you can find late in life, and yet he was able to reinvent himself in a completely new form of art. And he said, I've needed all that time to reach the stage where I can say what I want to say. And this is his painting called La Gerbe, which refers to a sheath. You picture a sheath of wheat as tightly bound, bland, colorless. His sheath is exploding with color and form. And that's a perfect analogy for what aging can be for each of us as we get older. And one of his last works of creation, the year before he died, was to design and create a chapel in France dedicated to the nurse who turned into a nun. He wanted to get dedicated to her. And he said, it is the whole of me, everything that was best in me as a child. So he took everything he had as a child through his entire lifetime, mixed together with everything he learned with age, his wisdom, his creativity, his resilience, and put it into this one extraordinary art form. And what's amazing is that not only in the 1940s was the world of fashion and art inspired by Matisse, but even today, if you look at any advertising, fashion, the use of bold colors all comes from Matisse. So again, this old man lying almost dead, decrepit in a bed, revolutionized our world, and we're still seeing and experiencing this today. So I call this the Matisse effect. This is accommodating and overcoming these age-related changes that occur to the brain that we know occur, but realizing that at the same time we have these age-conferred strengths, wisdom, purpose, creativity that can make all the difference. And this is truly what builds us the better brain. So, in conclusion, remember that really gloomy definition of aging I started off with. I want to return to that, but I'm redefining it based on everything we've learned in this talk. So I say that aging is a time-dependent series of cumulative, progressive, intrinsic, and positive cognitive, emotional, and behavioral changes that usually begin to manifest themselves at midlife and eventually culminate in increased well-being. And I would assert that this redefinition of aging is as accurate and as true as the initial definition we talked about, but it tells us the other side of the story. So in conclusion, let me quote from the great American poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, "For age is opportunity no less than youth itself, though in another dress. And as the evening twilight fades away, the sky is filled with stars, invisible by day." Thank you so much for your attention tonight. It truly has been an honor to speak to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Agronin. Really appreciate the positive emphasis that you shared with us today and the things that we can take away and learn and apply in our own lives. I just wanted to present Dr. Agronin with a small gift that will fit into his suitcase, hopefully to take with him back home.
No blanket?
We thought about a blanket, but we didn't think that would fit. So
in Miami, it might not go over to us.
Oh, that's true. Thank you so much,
Dr.
Agronin.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Appreciate it.